Father, we thank you again for this good day. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be here again. Lord, thank you that the weather was such that we could be here today. And that, Father, that you've allowed us to be in this place. Lord, I again do not think that anyone is here by accident, but that we are here by divine appointment. And Father, I pray this morning that something will be said that will be, Lord, a blessing and an encouragement to us. I pray, Lord, that you would overshadow us today, that, Lord, we might sense the real presence of God here, and that, Lord, we might leave here rejoicing in the fact that we have met with God today. Lord, a lot of places today will open their doors, and many places today will never even mention the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that our doors would be open and that, Lord, we would gladly welcome you here. Father, we thank you so very, very much for, Lord, your hand of healing in our lives. Lord, we want to pray for Deb today. Lord, having diverticulitis, and so, Lord, we do pray for her. Lord, pray that you would help her even now. She's gone down to the emergency room. Lord, there are just lots of people who have been sick, lots of people who continue to be sick, and, Lord, we pray that you would help them to feel better. Lord, a lot of it is just everyday colds, but, Lord, still make you feel miserable. Lord, so many people that I know, Lord, I think of my own brother, Lord, very sick, and I pray for him today, and Lord, I pray that you'd help him to feel better. Lord, I ask you'd help him to feel better, and Lord, we spend all day, Lord, we could spend all day mentioning people by name that we know that are in need of prayer. Lord, we could spend the rest of the morning mentioning people by name that we know that need to be saved. Lord, people who have walked through the doors of this church, and Lord, I know I'm not God, but in my opinion, walked through the doors lost and walked back out the doors lost. Father, I pray, Lord, for the lost today. Lord, we pray for those. Lord, we pray for those today. That, Lord Jesus, that you would bring some spirit of conviction upon their heart and life, that they might understand and realize that there is a heaven, that there is eternity. And, Lord, it stands before us that we are one breath, one heartbeat away, Lord, from crossing across to the other side. Lord, bless us, we pray today. Open your word to us. Give us clearness, we ask. This morning, Father, answer, I pray, Lord, the need of our heart. Father, I pray that you'll bless our time. Lord, I pray that you would encourage us, meet with us, we pray. And Lord, I pray that you'd help Doug figure out what's wrong there in the back. And Lord, we'll thank and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So did you get it? Did he get it? Not yet. All right. Okay, so. All right, we'll get started today. Anybody, I know everybody has questions about something, but if you have a question about the Bible today that you might like to ask, if you do, I'll surely try to answer a question. If you have a question today about anything, John.
Not a question, but I just wanted to tell you how good that message was on the radio this morning. Did a good job.
The woman at the well.
Yep.
I actually listened to that today. And I'm thinking, why would anybody listen to that guy? But, you know, I have a question to ask you. How many have ever heard the radio program? You've heard the radio program. Okay. Do I speak on the radio program like I speak here in Sunday school? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah. Boy. What, like idiot, moron, stupid?
Oh.
I never said anything like that. All right, we're moving on. Thank you, John. Thank you, John. That is, and we're not going to make a lot of comment, but that is a tremendous story about that woman. Come see a man that told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? John says and makes it very clear that many other things truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ. And one word that you will find mentioned over and over and over in the Gospel of John is that word Christ. He said, Andrew said to Peter, we have found the Messiah, which is by interpretation, the Christ. The woman said, is not this the Christ? The men of Samaria came out and said that we believe that this is the Christ, the Savior of the world. And you find that repeated over and over. And Christ simply means this, the anointed of God, and that's who Jesus was, the anointed of God. There's never has been, never will be. I hate to use the word, a person like the Lord Jesus. And so anyway, well, we're in Revelation. Anybody else got a question? If you have a question today, I'll surely try to answer it. If you have a question today, all right. And we are in Revelation chapter 10 today, getting down to... We have, of course, in chapter 10, we're just about, chapter 10 is a very short chapter in the book of Revelation. Actually, the book of Revelation is not very long at all. You probably could read the book of Revelation. If you're just an average, ordinary reader, you read the book of Revelation in less than an hour easily. And the Bible promises a special blessing to all those who read the book, who just simply read it. Now, of all the books in the New Testament, the book of Revelation is one strictly given over to prophecy. And we have mentioned that several times. The book of Revelation is a prophetic book. And that if you look at it any other way, really the book of Revelation will not make much sense to you. I again know people, I've met people, I've run into people who simply believe that A, that the Bible is an allegory, but B, that the book of Revelation is an allegory, and that you really cannot truly understand really what it means. I find that so difficult. I knew a guy when I lived in Texas, and he said this to me. He said, unless God Almighty himself comes down here and tells us what's in the Bible, nobody can understand it. Well, how stupid would that be? Why would God give us a book that we can't understand? Now, I realize, I do understand this, that there are things in the Bible that are hard to explain. And if I'd have been God, I probably would have said it a little bit different, but being I'm not God and God's a whole lot smarter than I am, there are some things that are hard to understand in the Bible. There are hard verses in the Bible. Some time to explain. I've said many times, I may not be able to tell you what a verse means. I can tell you what it doesn't mean. Because of the consistent teaching of the Bible, I can find verses in the Bible that would seem to indicate, that God has chosen this side of the church to go to heaven, and God has chosen this side of the church to go to hell. Now, there are people who believe that. I do not believe that. And I find this, that you can find verses like that in the Bible. Now, I may not be able to explain everything what those verses mean, but I can tell you what they don't mean. And I believe that God is a God of mercy, a God of grace, a God of love. It is an insult to the character of God to think that God would condemn people to hell. And I've said this to people who believe that. And they say to me, you don't believe that. And I say, are you asking me, do I believe that God created men and then caused men to sin and then gave men a Bible full of warnings and invitations to return to him and then fixed it so that some men could not return to him, so that they would go to hell just so that God in heaven could laugh about it? You're asking me, do I believe that? Absolutely not. Others, well, it's not exactly that way. Then you explain to me how it's not that way. Now, I may not be able to explain to you exactly what a verse may mean, but I can pretty well tell you from the consistent teaching of the Bible what certain verses do not mean. Look at John. You're there, and I know I'm jumping off, but look at John 15 for a minute. John chapter 15. And there are just a ton of verses that here's Bible says in 2 Peter 3:9, we're not going to look at it. We're looking at John chapter 15. But 2 Peter chapter 3, or yeah, 2 Peter 3:9 says that God is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but is long suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That all. Now they'll tell you, all does not mean all. Well, what does all mean? Well, it doesn't mean all. Now you show me one place in the Bible where all doesn't mean all. You show me a definition where all does not mean all. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Most people would take that verse to mean that God loved the world, and that whosoever would believe in him or trust him, put their faith in him, would have everlasting life. Now, that is the common sense meaning of that verse. But I have an acquaintance. I'll tell you how this is. Church I was saved in, Don McKnight was, man, that guy was a soul winner. I mean, that guy was a soul winner. Honestly, they started with 40-some people, and their Sunday school, when he died, was running over 900 people. Church got really quite large, running buses, and, you know, his son is one of those that believe that only certain people can go to heaven. The church runs about 120 people now. That's a shame. And I heard that guy say this. I heard him with my own ears. When God, it says in John 3:16, for God loved, so loved the whole world. I heard him say it. That does not mean, he said, that God loved the entire world. That God only loves people that he elected to go to heaven. That, my brethren, is an insult to the character, the integrity, and the love of God. Look at John 15. Says this, down about verse 15. Henceforth I call you not servant, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. Boy, isn't that a great thing? For all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Now verse 16. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. Boom. That's where they stop. I've heard them. They use that. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. And what they say to that is this. See, God chose this side of the church to go to heaven. The rest of you are out of luck. You can't go to heaven because God only chose this side to go to heaven. This side can't go to heaven. You may want to go to heaven. And I'll tell you how far they go. I didn't mean to get on this, but I'm going to say this. I'll tell you how far they go. We've got our good friend Bob, the math teacher, over here. And Bob says, God, I want to go to heaven. Well, I'm sorry, Bob. You can't go to heaven because God has not chosen you. This is what they say. I've read it, that God will send him a false belief to make him think he is going to heaven, even though he's not going to heaven. I said to one of them one day, I said to one of those guys one day, I said, how do you know you're going to heaven? Well, I just know. I said, how do you know that God has not sent you a false belief? He said, well, no, God doesn't. But that's what they really believe. And so they take that verse, John 15:16, and says, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. Now, that's not what that verse says. Read on. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you, that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. If you read that verse, it is obvious It's not talking about salvation. Wait a minute, Ryan. Let me say this. Then I'll get your question. John 15 is not even talking about salvation. It's not even talking about that. If you read it, it's talking about getting answers to prayer and fruit. I know people that say that, well, John 15, verse 16 means that, man, you ought to go out, you ought to be getting people right and left, and that isn't even what it means. But anyway, Ryan. I mean, what? I'm not quite following you on that.
That God elected just certain people. For example, I know someone who believes that way. Oh, and his wife is supposedly saved, and all his children are saved. But if that's really the way God worked, I wouldn't think the whole family would be. And I didn't know if they maybe explained that to you.
I'll tell you. If I said who this was, you know who it was immediately. And I got the second hand. I got it from Rich. And so if it's not true, you can blame Rich for it. But you can blame him for anything you want. But, you know, it's like he's got big shoulders. Rich told me that a person told them this, that they believe that they were elected to go to heaven. But if their children were not, and that God had elected them to go to hell, they were okay with that. How could you possibly be okay with that? How could you be okay with the idea that your kids are going to spend eternity in the lake of fire burning forever and ever? I mean, that just, to me, that defies logic. Bible says in Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. We, brethren, God is a reasonable God, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Now, that does not mean that everybody will be saved. As a matter of fact, the Bible indicates that very few will be saved. Relatively speaking, when you think of all the billions of people who have ever lived, very few will be saved. Most people just aren't interested. Kim?
Along those lines, God knows who is going to be saved.
Absolutely, he does.
People are written in the book of life, correct? Is that what the book of life is?
Okay, go ahead. You're asking me. Okay. She said, does God know who will be saved? Absolutely. Does God know everything? Does God know everything? Yes or no? Yes, he does. So to say that God does not know who will be saved and who will not be saved is ridiculous, because God knows everything. So then the question is, well, does God choose those people? Notice Romans chapter 8. Could we look at that for a moment? Romans chapter 8. Notice what Paul writes to us here under the influence, of course, of the Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 8. And this is important, because this is where people kind of get confused and get the order mixed up. Verse 28. And we know that all things work together to good. I'm sorry. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Now, verse 29 is so important. For whom he did foreknow. Did God foreknow who would be and who would not be saved? Absolutely, he did. To say that God chose those people to go to heaven is Can I just say this is silly? But, say, well, preacher, why do people want, why would people want to believe that? I think there are several reasons why people would choose to believe that. One, it gives them an out for never having to do anything. Now, I don't mind talking to people who are Calvinistic in what they believe, as long as they don't want to start, like liberals, start calling you names and stuff like that. I had a guy call me one time. I was trying to talk to a guy, and he said, what are you, an Arminian? I said, no. He said, well, what are you? I said, I'm a biblicist. Oh, you're one of those guys. Yeah, I believe the Bible. One, it gives them an out for never having to do anything, because if you truly believe that a person has been elected to be saved, and I said this to one of them one time, if you really believe that, you can't believe you were ever lost. You can't have been lost. There's no way you could have ever been lost, because A, you've been eternally loved from the foundation of the world, and secondly, you've been elected to eternal life. You could have never been lost. Well, that's our favorite argument. Well, the second thing is this. Paul says in Corinthians, I believe, that we ought not to be removed from the simplicity that is in Christ. May I say to you that the simplest thing in the world is to be saved? Now, it's difficult. You say, well, why is that, preacher? Because people don't like to admit they're sinners. Guy I graduated from high school with, who I know very well, said, I've never done anything bad enough to go to hell. Now, I know him, and I know he has, but people just don't want to admit they're sinners. But to be saved is just simple childlike trust in the Lord Jesus. That a five-year-old could do that. If they truly understand, and I don't want to go down that road too far, but if they truly understand, they could be saved easily. But it's simple. But the Calvinist wants to seem to be intellectual. Well, you just don't understand. If I've been told that once, I've been told dozens of times. You just don't understand. I do understand. I understand that you don't want to seem to be a nitwit, because you say, well, I believe in the simplicity of the cross. I believe in the simplicity of salvation. Yeah, but it's so complicated. It's so complex. And that, I agree that, you know, the plan of salvation, I mean, all the parts that had to work out. But it's so simple that even a child can understand it and be saved. And so to answer Kim's question, look at 2 Peter for a moment. We saw that word foreknow. For whom he did foreknow. He did foreknow. Maybe 1 Peter chapter 1. Yeah, it is. I'm sorry, it's 1 Peter chapter 1. Here we find this again. Verse 1, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Notice in verse 2, elect according to the foreknowledge of God. I may be one of the elect, and we are, but it's not based upon some arbitrary whim that God had of choosing one side over the other. It was based upon God in eternity knew what I would do when presented with the opportunity to trust Christ. We are the elect based upon the foreknowledge of God. Does God know who and who will not be saved? Absolutely. I think this. Kim mentioned, does God know everybody who is written in the book of life? We talked about this one Sunday. I believe that everybody's name is written in the book of life. As I read the Bible and try to understand the Bible, I think that everybody that has ever been born, their name was written in the book of life. And the evangelist is told in John, the evangelist, John, is told by the Lord Jesus, to him that overcometh, I will not blot out of the book of life. I will not blot his name out of the book of life.
Revelation 3:5.
To him that overcometh. You say, well, what's an overcomer? Well, let me give you the Bible definition. Who is he that overcometh but he that believeth that Jesus is the Christ? All right, so we overcome by believing on the Lord Jesus. Here's how I believe gracious God is. I think everybody's name is written in the book of life, but their name is blotted out when they die. We talked several weeks ago about the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Me, and again, I know good people disagree on this, but to me, blaspheming the Holy Spirit is to reject the Holy Spirit till the day that you die. Then that cannot be forgiven, that unbelief. And so does God know who will be saved, who will not be saved? Absolutely, he does. And so, anyway. Anybody? Yes, sir. Brother Pete?
You know, you talk about does God choose people. You know, I think my opinion is that we're the ones that choose. And then God chooses who he's going to use by our obedience and how deep we go with him. But the first choice is ours. And he knows what we're going to choose, but we're not that deep. We can't go beyond step one. If we don't go to step one, we can't go to step two and worry about who's the chosen and who's not the chosen. We're the ones that have to do step one.
And what Pete said, it all comes down to whether or not you believe that man has a free will to choose. The Calvinist would say a man does not have a free will to choose, that God overpowers that person, and whether they want to be saved or not, they're going to be saved. God just overpowers them. Or you believe that man has a free will to choose. As Joshua said, choose you this day whom you will serve. I go all the way back to the Garden of Eden. You remember when God drove Adam and Eve out of the garden? And what did he put at the... I think it says that he drove them eastward. What did God put at the end of the garden to keep them from going back in? Angel with a flaming sword. Now, if Adam and Eve did not have a free will, if Adam and Eve did not want to get back to God, why did God have to put that angel there to keep them from trying to get back into the Garden of Eden? It's because people have a will to choose. Jesus said this, I can't tell you where in the Gospels, but that he said this. He said, you will not come that you might have life. He didn't say you can't come. He said, you will. Your will is what keeps you from coming to Christ. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Pete made the comment about choosing. I've read this several times. Perhaps you have read it. We are free to choose. We are free to choose. But we are not free to choose the consequences of what our choice was. You may choose freely, but the consequences of your choice, you're not free to choose. So anyway, all right. Anybody else got a thought, comment? Yes, first Kim.
Well, I just didn't
I found something in Exodus. Exodus 32:23. Yeah, you're right. And the Lord said unto Moses, whoever has sinned against him, against me, him I will blot out of my book. But that's, of course, before Jesus came. And then...
Okay, look at Numbers 32. Wait a minute. Numbers, is that what you said, Numbers 32?
Exodus.
Exodus, right. I believe that Numbers is, be sure your sin will find you out, but, excuse me, Numbers 32, Exodus 32. I don't know why I got numbers on my mind. Exodus 32. Verse 23. 33. I am looking. I'm just asking. Numbers 32:23. All right, we're at 23 first of all. If I'm reading 32:23, all right.
32:33.
You're right, John. It's 33. What's my name? Okay. And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. However, I am looking for in Exodus. In Exodus, if you hadn't said that, maybe it's Exodus 23 that I'm looking for. Moses says, and I can't find it. All right. Moses says, after he comes down from Mount Sinai, you remember the thing about the golden calf? And they are worshiping the golden calf. God says, all right, Moses, I am through with Israel. I'm going to destroy Israel, and I'm going to make you a great nation. And Moses says to him, to God, and it may be in chapter 32, and I just don't see it.
It's 32, for
sure. Yeah.
32, yeah. 32.
Yeah, I got that far. I'm there. Moses actually says to God, and maybe you can find this. He said, okay, God. He said, if you will not forgive them, then blot my name. Okay. You have got me so confused this morning. I have to tell you, it's because I've been deprived of Coke for a month. I haven't drank Coke in a month, and I'm like going crazy. But anyway. And Moses, let's go to verse 30. And it came to pass on the morrow that Moses said unto the people, ye have sinned a great sin. Now I will go unto the Lord. Peradventure I shall make an atonement for your sin. And Moses returned unto the Lord and said, oh, this people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if thou wilt not forgive their sin, dash. Moses does not complete it. And if not, Moses goes so far as to, he doesn't even want to go there. He doesn't even want to question that. And if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book, which thou hast written. Moses said, blot me out. Paul said in Romans chapter 11, he said, I could wish myself accursed for Israel Moses loved Israel so much that he said, God, if you won't forgive their sin, God, if you will not forgive their sin, then I'm through with you and blot my name out of the book. Brother, that's quite a bold statement to make to God. But then God said, well, I'll tell you what. He said, verse 33, and the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever hath sinned against me, him I will blot out of my book. Therefore now go, lead the people unto the place which I have spoken unto thee. Behold, mine angels shall go before thee. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit, I will visit their sin upon them. And the Lord plagued the people because they made the calf, which Aaron made. Of course, Aaron was a hypocrite. He made the calf. He said, well, we threw the gold in the fire, and that's what jumped out. Now, that isn't true. I'll tell you what's interesting. If you go online, go to Google, and search for Mount Sinai, the Mount Sinai that they went to in Arabia, and Google that, and then go to images. You'll be reminded that when God came down, the top of the mountain was on fire. There at Mount Sinai, at those mountains, the mountains are still black on the very top. And at the bottom of Mount Sinai, you can see where the encampment of Israel was. And there's this big thing, stone built up thing there where they believe that the golden calf actually was. I mean, that is really interesting. But Moses said, blot me out, blot me out, blot me out. David said, blot mine enemies out of thy book. So evidently, if God's going to blot people's names out, then my opinion is that everybody's name was written there. And God is so gracious. He didn't want anybody to miss heaven, so God wrote everybody's name there. And if when a person dies, they die without Christ, then they will be blotted out of the book. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast in the lake of fire. John, yet you wanted to say something. I don't know if you...
Well, it's all to our advantage for reproof and...
Yes, it is.
...understanding. But the epistles of John and Peter and James and Revelations, those were all written for the Jews. They were Jewish epistles.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm just saying that they were basically for the Jewish people. And, of course, we've taken them to the point where, you know, we lose sight of that.
Okay. Anybody else? You got a comment? You got a thought about the book of Ken?
That particular verse with Moses having his name blotted out.
Yes.
You can look at it, God loves your soul so much that he's not willing to blot your name out for anything.
No, he's not willing to do that.
And if you're doing things the way you're supposed to with David, you know, he already knew his enemies weren't going to, you know, God foreknew that, whether he did or not blotted their names out.
Right.
You know, if you're living right the way you're supposed to, you know, you can use that.
Okay. Pete, got a comment?
I was just thinking, you know, the idea of blotting your name out, that's what Adam did. He had his name taken out, in a sense, to be with his wife. And it was almost a picture of what Moses said that he would do, mm-hmm. or was willing to do, uh-huh. if God wouldn't forgive him. Went the ultimate and chose to sin and disobey God to be with his wife. And Moses was willing to do that to be with his people.
You know, that whole thing about Adam and Eve and what Pete just brought up is absolutely amazing. Of course, if you're the only two people in the world, we think they were the only two people. Now, I'm not saying that God created other people, but depending upon how long they were in the Garden of Eden, Cain and Abel may have been running around by then. We don't know that. We'll just say that they weren't. But if you're the only two people in the world and God said, if you eat of that tree, you're going to die. And if your wife ate of that tree and she's going to die. And you think about the choice Adam had. Yeah, God, he had Eve. God, Eve. God, Eve. God, Eve. God or Eve. You say, well, why didn't he choose God? God could have took another rib out. Made smile. Because we're nearsighted. We only see what's good right now. And Adam looked at Eve and said, God or Eve, I'll take Eve. There are a lot of pictures that could be drawn from that. The Bible says in Ephesians that men ought to love their wives, even as Christ also loved the church. He gave himself for it. What did Adam do? He died with his wife. So I read this one time. God said that the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. And he said, well, Adam did not die that day. Well, no, he didn't. But we also know this, and you can take it for whatever it's worth, that 1,000 years is but a day to the Lord. Adam did not live to be 1,000 years old. So Adam actually died in that day, as God sees it. Adam did die in that day. The day he ate of it, he died. Now you say, well, he lived 1,000 years. Well, not with God. He didn't live to be 1,000 years old, and so the day that he ate of it, in that day, I know he lived to be 960 years old, I believe, but he did die. Here's the other picture. How much did Adam love his wife? Think about it a minute. How much did Adam love his wife? Think about that. He gave up everything. He gave up everything. What'd you say, Ken? Cost him his soul. It cost him everything. You just stop and try to grasp that for a minute. It cost him everything to choose his wife. That just staggers, really. When you think about that, that staggers the imagination. Garden of Eden, God, everything you ever wanted right there. She disobeyed. See you later. God will do something, I'm sure. Give me. But no. He gave up everything for his wife. Now, would you, one second, John, and I'll get to you. Would you be willing, fellas, would you be willing to do that? But now think about this. That's just what Jesus did for the church. He gave up everything. We've sung that song many times. He left the splendor of heaven, knowing his destiny. 'Twas the lonely hill of Golgotha where he suffered and died for me. If that isn't love. Look, you think about that. Jesus left heaven and he prayed in John 17. Lord, restore to me now the glory which I shared with thee before the world was, before the world began. When Jesus was in heaven and they fellowshipped and the Son was in the bosom of the Father and he left heaven and he left the angels and he left all that, the glory and the splendor of heaven, he left all that, came down here, lived among sinful men, was spit upon, laughed at, beaten, mocked, crucified on a cross. One reason. He loved the church that much. That he willingly gave up everything for the church. He did exactly what Adam did. He loved the church so much that he willingly gave up his life for that. When John said everything, what did Adam give up? Brother, I'm telling you, he gave up everything. John, and then Kim.
This thought has crossed my mind several times. If they took your children and stood them up on that front of that table and said they were going to cut their heads off, unless you became a Muslim, what would you do? Did you ever think about that? What would it take?
I thought about that. I think about that stuff all the time.
What would it take for you to turn your back on Jesus?
And you know, John says that, and you think about it, with the Apostle Peter, it didn't take much. A hot fire is all it took with Peter. But you think about over the years, you think about the Waldenses, the Albigenses, those kind of people who were persecuted mercilessly. I read of one account where the Catholics hounded the Waldenses to a cave up in the mountains, and they were all in there. 300 of them were in there. And the Catholics built a fire on the outside, and the people on the inside suffocated. Say, we often say, well, I would do that, preacher. You never know what you'll do till you get there, but you might need to think about that. We do live in troublesome times. The Muslims in America chant death to America all the time. I mean, they chant that. But anyway, Kim, you wanted to say something.
The other people in the Bible,
yes,
who, praise God, you know, who, like Moses or Abraham is the one that comes to mind,
yes,
who had sinned against God, or David, who had sinned,
yes,
and later on repented.
Yes.
Could Adam and Eve had done, could they have repented after they got kicked out of the garden and still be in heaven?
Okay, my answer to the
very last thing you said is this. I believe Adam and Eve are in heaven. Okay? I believe that they are in heaven. I have little doubt that Adam and Eve are in heaven. There's a couple reasons for that. Because Abel, somehow or other, Abel knew to offer a blood sacrifice. And when I call it this, you've probably heard me refer to this before, Adam and Eve had what I call fig leaf religion. That once they realized that their eyes were open, they realized they were naked, they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons out of the fig leaves, and they were satisfied with that until God showed up. And then they ran and hid. So then after they're out of the garden, God made them clothes out of animal skins, which means that God sacrificed an innocent animal for Adam and Eve. So to answer your question, I believe that Adam and Eve are in heaven. I believe that we will see them. And that. Now, the first part of your question, did they repent? The word repent means, of course, to change your mind, which would lead to a change of action in your life. Did Adam and Eve do that? Well, when God showed up, they were truly sorry, because God said, who told you you were naked? And Adam blamed Eve for it. He said it's all her fault. And then Eve blamed the serpent. Not only did Adam blame Eve, Adam blamed God. Adam blamed God and said, God, it's all your fault, because the woman that thou gavest me. If you hadn't given me that woman, God, this would have never happened. So God, in reality, it's really all your fault, not my fault. Eve just said, well, the serpent made me do it. I didn't know what I was doing, which the Bible indicates she did not know what she was doing. She was deceived. The serpent thou gave it, that the serpent beguiled me, and I was deceived. I didn't really know. I was out of my mind. I didn't know what I was doing. It was just, that's the way it was. And so, did Adam and Eve repent? Yeah, when God cast them out of the garden, I believe that they were truly sorry. And when they, John Milton wrote that book, Paradise Lost, I mean, how they must have felt when they were driven from the garden. I'm going to give Brian the last chance here.
I was
Right.
So they still end up going to heaven. They're still saved, but their entire life changed, and they had to deal with the consequences of the choice.
Absolutely. It's like my dad. It's like here now. You're free to choose. You are free to choose. But you are not free to choose the consequences of what your choice has been. And I won't even use that. I'll just use people in general. People who choose to live a sinful lifestyle, you know, they suffer the consequences of it. Dad smoked for 40 years. He died of lung cancer. Just because you get saved doesn't mean that you're free from the consequences of what you did. So, you know, but anyway, we're done. No, we're finished. Cakes are done. People are finished. So we are finished today. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you, Lord, for your great love to us. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, that our names are written in that book. Oh, how we thank you for that. Lord, it seems kind of obvious that people's names, everybody's name is there. But, Lord, it's blotted out when they leave this world without Jesus. So, Father, we thank you again today for the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for his mercy and for his grace. Thank you, Lord, for all that many, 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 many things you have done, Lord, not only saved us, but, Lord, Lord, we are kept by the word of thy power. Lord, bless, we pray now as the hour does continue on. Lord, give us a great service. Thank you for the Sunday school hour. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord, people to ask questions, to participate, Lord. And Lord, help us to again rightly divide the word of truth. Now bless us, we pray, as our hour does continue on. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.